How should entrepreneurs think about developing their understanding of the decision-making unit?
Well, the first thing we've got, you know, it's what are the different functions, you know, the primary and additional roles, the economic, all those things we've got. Once you have that, now the question is go out, you have to do primary market research, you have to talk to customers, you have to say, you know, who's the economic buyer? But you don't go out and say, are you the economic buyer? There's a little more finesse here about how you do it. So you have to go out and talk to people and say, you know, who needs to be involved to make this project happen? And then you listen to what they say and you hear names. And then you go to the other people and say, who needs to be involved to make this happen? Who will really drive this? And then you start hearing the people over and over again. Then you can start to guess at who the right people are, and then you can start zeroing in. But it's delicate, and you know, we'll put it back to you. You never go up to someone and say, you know, do you have the money to do this or not? it will offend them. So there's finesse here. How did you do it, Jan?
Yeah, so we started with basically searching MIT alumni database, and we started to reach out to people. Of course, we have no idea who these people are, right? Like, we don't know which role they play. But usually, we end up like talking with people who are in the ad sales department.
So you had a friendly kind of in, and then you asked them who it was.
Yeah.
And then they kept steering you to the ad sales department.
Exactly. Then we started to chat with folks at sales department, but they're not very interested in our data itself. Like, they understand our value proposition, but they're not good at data. So they told us, okay, so why not talking with ad sales research people, and these people are good at data, and they're gonna help us to understand how we can really use your data. Mm-hmm. So then basically they introduced us to ad sales research. Mm-hmm. Then we had conversation with ad sales research, and every time I saw a gentleman like attend this meeting, and first I don't know who that person is, then later on I found out that's head of research.
Yeah.
Because he wants to make sure these startups coming to this new organization is really legit.
So I think this is, Erdin, I think this is really important. You know, you go in, you have friendly person, and then you got your camel's nose in the tent, and you ask questions, and you're always observing who's coming in the room, and you're watching the nonverbal interactions. And I think Jan just talked about, there was always this person in the room, and you know, maybe were they quiet, or how did you?
They're very quiet.
They're very quiet.
And they look very busy. They never engage with us. Like basically, head of research usually like working something else on laptop.
Yeah.
Maybe overhearing some of our conversation. So yeah. I even don't know who that person is. But later I ask, then they told me, oh, that's head of research. And but now he's very busy. You don't need to talk with him. Let's keep the conversation.
And this is very, very common, is that the fact that if you just ask them to map it out, they don't even know it sometimes themselves. You have to kind of do this archaeological dig to figure out what's going on. And in some sense, that creates you becoming a very powerful person, because you understand their decision-making process even better than them.
Yeah.
And that is pure gold.
Mm-hmm. So I'm sure it's very easy to think of the head of research as unimportant, because that person doesn't participate in the process. But that would be a major mistake.
So we actually made that mistake by only trying to convincing ad sales department, even not ad sales research, only ad sales department, convince them, oh, this is the right product to use, you should really use it, we can offer some free trial, like a couple months, just use it. But these people are never gonna use that because they really don't understand how to use our data, how to use our solution. Only research people can help them to translate our data into insights.
How did you realize you made the mistake?
Because we tried that strategy for a couple of months, it didn't move anywhere.
Yeah.
Then since these people, like ad sales folks, already lost interest in our company, then maybe like only people we can talk is research. So
yeah.
that's why we end up talking with research. Then they are very exciting because they never saw this kind of data. They think this is really cool. Then they start to dig into our data and they want to bring value from research to ad sales.
And Bill, I'm sure, and you've seen many startups, you can't really understand the decision-making unit without making mistakes. Mistakes are very common in this process.
It's an iterative process, and it's not like it's an equation. Every single company is not exactly the same. What you're trying to do is find the kind of structure, the model that's the most common amongst all of them, so you can replicate it. but it's not exactly the same. Did you find that, Jan, in
yeah,
your situation?
Even for TV networks, different TV network has slightly different organization structure, so we cannot assume like all TV networks has exactly same DMU because like it's not, and we need to spend time to understand that carefully.
At least you had a model when you went in, and then you could take it 10 degrees to the right, 10 degrees to the left, but you walked in and they were, and you know, they're usually very impressed that you understand so quickly, you know, and they start feeling comfortable with you, and the discussion just moves at a much faster rate if you already have a straw man out there of the DMU. But then you have to tweak it a little bit for each customer situation. But it's still a very powerful framework. It's very useful.
Yeah, so the first time is the most difficult time for us.
Yeah, over time it gets better and better, or as we talked about, it gets closer and closer and closer and closer. But the interesting thing as well is that it can change over time. And I don't know if you've seen any of that, Jan. Have you seen it changing over time?
We don't see that too much. Like we just started, so maybe, but maybe we're going to see this in the future.
Yeah. So user behavior can change over time, and understanding the decision-making unit and their how that evolves is very, very important.